بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. In today's pep talk about the status of children born to unmarried parents in Islam, or as it is referred to them in our books of fiqh in the jurisprudence of the Islamic sciences, they call them children or sons of fornication, ibn zina, and they always refer to them like that in our books of fiqh, and I will come back to this issue later on, inshallah. The reason I am speaking about this issue, about those kids born out of wedlock parents, is one day I received a question in the group, and the question was about this lady who is married already and has got like 4 kids with her husband, more than a decade of marriage, who learned suddenly that she was not born when her parents were married. This made her panic, and she went ahead and told her husband, and he started getting panicking as well. And then the question was, how about our marriage? Is our Islamic marriage that we conducted, is it valid? What is the status of our children? Are they also valid? And that, subhanAllah, created a sense of loss in them. And obviously the husband started distancing himself, and they separated eventually because the husband told his wife that she was a daughter of fornication and she was a daughter of an act of haram, and as such she was haram. This understanding of this man here is maybe astonishing to us living in the West, who live amongst people who always have children and the parents are not married. But in the Muslim world, you'll be surprised to know that the majority of Muslims around the world hold the same opinion as this gentleman here. They regard the children who are born out of marriage as sons of fornication. And this is a huge problem. Even if you ask a sheikh in the masjid, he will tell you that those kids have issues with them, as I will elaborate later. But the problem is, all those things that we are taught today about those children, have they really been studied as they ought to be? Or are we just repeating what has been already said before? In this pep talk here, I'm not going to just say 2 words about this issue. I want to cover it from all angles so that you understand why this issue is extremely important. After all, it deals with the life of a human being, a child. And also, so that when you speak to people, you have enough evidences under your belt to help these people see clarity on how they interact with these kids. And I will start in this pep talk here speaking about marriage. What is marriage? Why do we get married? Well, as it turns out, that bringing a child to the world is such an experience that only those who have witnessed it know the true magic and mysticism that comes with it. Even those who aren't parents yet will see its beauty whenever a newborn baby comes into their family. And even though humans have reached a very high level in medicine, where they can these days fix humans, they can fix their hearts, bones, muscles, they can even transplant a human's face onto another, yet these and any future great medical accomplishments will pale to nothingness in front of the miracle of a human's birth, the manifestation of a miracle that takes place right in front of your very eyes. When a baby is born, my dear sisters and my brothers, it becomes such a great opportunity for any human around the entire earth to celebrate. People are always happy when a newborn baby graces their houses. When a newborn baby comes to earth, truly color, religion, ethnicity, gender, or nationality all come together to celebrate the coming of a new life. Wherever you go on earth, people celebrate differently maybe, but they do celebrate the birth of a new life, a new child. This is why Allah made the birth of a newborn baby on earth such a celebration, just like that when the angels celebrated the birth of our father Adam. Allah knows that the coming of a new soul to earth is no easy task for humans, yet He attached with it some incredible emotions that humans feel, but they can't explain. There is just something short of miracle seeing a kid in front of your eyes. In the kingdom of animals, before a child, baby, cub is born, animals always prepare for that cub or that baby or that child of theirs to come to life. And this is coded in their genomes, known as instinct. Animals follow these instructions and their babies are born. But for us humans, Allah in His infinite wisdom has designed and built a protocol to which humans must abide and go through before bringing a new soul to earth. That protocol is also known as marriage, wedlock, unison, or any similar terms used in different languages. In order for me to illustrate the meaning of marriage, let me give you an example, and that analogy will help us, inshallah, understand what the true meaning of marriage is. Say somebody invites you to visit their home. When you enter the home, you enter their realm. You follow their rules. You follow their protocols. You sit where they tell you to sit. If they remove their shoes, you remove your shoes. If they ask you to remove your shoes, you remove your shoes. If they tell you to put your something there, you put it there. So everything that you do within that house will go according to the house owner. The same analogy can be used when it comes to inviting or bringing in a new soul to earth. We all know that the earth belongs to Allah and that Allah has set rules to be followed for those who are on earth. He promised those who follow His sets of law great rewards on Judgment Day, and to those who break the rules, they will experience His wrath and punishment. It is Allah who designed and built earth. And one of His rules to bring in newcomers to this earth is that we must follow the rule He set. And that rule is getting married. We just can't invite a newcomer without taking into consideration the protocol for that invitation. Again, that protocol is what is known as marriage. Just like the meat we eat, we can't eat it without pronouncing the name of Allah when we slaughter it. Because, as I already said before, when you slaughter, taking a life or taking an animal's life, you have no right to do that. The only right for us to slaughter an animal is when we utter the name of Allah on it. And that gives us the permission to eat it. So again, for the child, we can't invite a child to earth without following the set of protocol that Allah has designed for us, and that is to get married. Ask any woman who has given birth, and she will tell you that 9 months is about as big as a child can get and still be born without killing the mother. Problem is, 9 months isn't enough time to get everything fully operational inside the human body. So Allah, in the way He designed things, gave us a better work around these endless limitations. What I mean by this, when a child is born, 9 months, he doesn't have knowledge at all. Yes, we come equipped with what we need to learn, arms, legs, eyes, and all that kind of stuff. But when it comes to really dealing with life, we absolutely have nothing at all. So we are basically born with all the parts to carry whatever we need to do to survive and excel on earth. In other words, Allah provided us with a toolkit box to finish the manufacturing of ourselves post-birth, after birth. But that toolbox is so complex that if we were left alone, we wouldn't know where to start and where to finish. So Allah allocated to each and every human 2 full-time teachers, care workers, doctors, chefs, drivers, nurses, bodyguards, entertainers, and also clowns, or else known as parents. A human's progress, my dear sisters and my brothers, is totally different to that of an animal. And this is why we humans take a year plus to learn to walk. We have to build up the required parts and equipment to do so. Same for our emotional and sexual reproduction and pretty much everything else. This is why a traumatized or abused child will carry that emotional load for the rest of their lives. And also, this is why Allah put such a gigantic emphasis on the balance and harmony of parents, and later on demands a great deal of respect from the children towards their parents. And that's because bringing a child to earth, then care for it till it reaches a physical and emotional level where it can carry on learning on its own is very serious business. And Allah will not let ungratefulness go unpunished both in this life and in the hereafter. It is the duty of parents to ensure that a child is well nurtured, nourished, emotionalized, protected, and reassured for far longer than any other creature on earth. Humans, we take care of our babies far more longer than any other creature on earth. For many years, human children are completely defenseless and dependable. This is in contrast with the laws of the jungle, where there is a tendency to favor the fittest and strongest that will most likely survive. With a great pinch of salt about this theory, because Allah has written a lifespan for all animals, strong or weak, big or small, predator or meek prey. This is also why before bringing a child to earth, Allah designed the humans to make certain serious preparations for that very event. But if these well-important preparations were made plainly for children alone, then guess what? People would never, ever wanna get children alone. They would run away from the said preparations because nobody wants to do boring things for a long period of time. After all, who would want to bring crying, sleepless, and annoyed children into their busy lives? Who would want to run errands, do chores all the time for them, only to be faced when they are in their teenagerhood with the blunt faces of people as if you've done nothing for them throughout their lives? So Allah linked the whole childbirth thing in such a complex manner that it all crosses the human's desires to see their offspring and witness their growth. What I mean by that? If Allah didn't link our sexual needs to bringing the kids, the mother would not suffer the pains of giving birth. And the father, who heck, I don't want to have children because I don't want to spend my money on and all that kind of stuff. But Allah has entwined and linked all the systems around each other. To have a baby, you need to have a sexual relationship. And sexual relationship is a further exploring and also expressing our emotions. Our emotions create that contact between the man and the woman. And it all tangles up against each other, within each other, on top of each other, and across each other. And at the end of it, that's when a baby comes to earth, we are so full of joy because that child stands for all these complex emotions and sexual experiences that we have witnessed and experienced. Look at it this way. Allah designed the need of a human to want to be with the opposite sex, and people go to extremes to be with each other. Allah amplified that awesome feeling of love that a human experienced at much higher and deeper level. When a couple meet and they hit it off, they want to share as much possible with each other as they can. From their time together to the foods they eat, places they visit, activities they do together, and when they feel they are ready for the next level of emotional and physical connection, they take the next biggest step in their lives, and that is a life commitment to each other called marriage. This life commitment is to love, support for, and stand by for each other in times of joy and sadness, easiness and hardship. And just like a serious business deal, they sign their commitment contract through a set of rituals and practices known as marriage. As soon as the man and woman get committed, they wish to express their deepest and most sincere love for more than ever before, and so they take the sexual intimacy route. Yet, that route, even though it can be used to express a deeper need or sexual desires and just plain desires, it is also the primary function to help new souls come to earth. If Allah hadn't linked children with our sexual needs, no human would ever care producing one single child, and humanity would have come to its end a lot sooner than our times. We probably would never have seen the light of the days ourselves. Marriage carries more than a meaning. Even though it is a commitment for the adults, but it also is a guaranteed, safe, protective, and harmonious environment to bring children into this world. This is why Allah prohibited fornication or any sexual relationship or anything that leads or lures to it outside the marriage contract. Allah knows, and so do humans, that sexual relationship between a man and a woman will lead to the production of a new soul or new souls. And since humans aren't responsible enough to know what's good for them and what's not, Allah set some guiding laws to show them what's good for them and what's not. And that is the deen, the religion, or the religion and the relationship between them and their God, Allah. These divine laws, in the form of marriage or unison contract, will help them regulate their human physical inner connections. And this is why fornication is haram in all religions of the earth, including the Abrahamic religion. But adult humans have reached that stage where they behave just like those children who have reached the age of I know better than anyone else and will refuse to abide by any dictated rules. Those adults decided to look for the physical gratifications, i.e. sexual contact. They designed ways and means to enjoy their sexology while doing their very best to keep away from the fruits of such interaction. Children, that's why you have condoms, you have all these contraceptions, is to help people enjoy sex without the result of that, and these are children. Obviously, in Islam, if you want to do that, that's absolutely fine. But I'm talking about people that are not married and they only chase the sex god, always wanting to enjoy sex without any responsibilities for the children. But what these adults are doing is well known to and well seen by Allah. And even though Allah has warned of the consequences of fornication, humans still are fully heedless of these warnings. And the results are well seen these days, with a huge increase in the number of children that are born out of a wedlock and the breaking of families due to marital illegal affairs. The preventive laws that Allah set to protect the human offspring go all the way back to that fateful day when Allah said to the angels, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. I am going to place a khalifa on earth. The term khalifa can have two possible meanings. One is the viceroy, is the successor, and the second one is the succeeding offspring. Both meanings are complexly entwined. We succeed one another, as in your children come after you, and you came after your parents. And they also inherit some of your traits, looks, behavior, carry your name and deeds to the generations of the future. Just as you carry within you the whole list of those that have come before you till you go back to our father Adam. So you are the son of your parents, and the parents are the sons of their parents, until you go back all the way to our father Adam. This is why marriage is such an important matter, and the most sanctified contract to humans of different sex can enter into under God. My dear sisters and my brothers, there are so many different types of marriages, and this pep talk is not about marriage per se, but it is about the understanding of the true meaning of marriage, because this is essential to fully grasp the issue of the children born out of a wedlock. Also, it is needed to understand why humans marry and why those who don't marry are looked at differently than those who do. And before I embark on this matter, I want to say first that by marriage, I mean what each and every community around the world and in every part of the earth agreed to, that when two people do certain acts or rituals, the rest of the community understands that the couple is entering into a marital bond. It does not have to be the way we Muslim marry. I repeat, marriages around the world are valid according to their communities. They do not have to be the way we Muslim marry. For example, if somewhere in the depth of Africa, a man came home with a lion on his back and then lays it, the lion, down at the feet of a woman, and that meant that they are getting married, and if the woman cut off a bit of the lion's mane and handed it over to the man meant that they are now married, then any child born after that is child born into a wedlock, as long as the community understands that that is a marriage. Or if a Buddhist married according to their own designed rituals and the community understands by that that the couple is now married, then the marriage is accepted by Islam. And so is any marriage conducted in a church, synagogue, or any other community. Even atheists, when they marry the way they marry, and people understand that they are married, that is a valid marriage in the sight of Islam. Islam acknowledges any designed and accepted unison between two people of different sex. This is why when people entered Islam at the time of Rasulullah ﷺ in Mecca, and after that in Al-Madinah, and thereafter, nobody ever asked any of them to get remarried again, or that their marriage, no matter how it was done, was void or anything of that ilk. Even people who entered Islam today aren't asked to remarry again or do anything any different than what they did before, even if they were atheists. Even if two people of different religions, let's say Christian or Jewish, were just cohabiting with each other and then embraced Islam, and their children are considered in Islam as children born in a wedlock. Surprised? Well, you should be. Here is a question that was posed to Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, Allah have mercy in his soul. Someone asking about a serious problem which faces most of those who enter Islam in the West, which is that before they became Muslim, they used to commit fornication, and that resulted in many children. They were cohabiting each other, boyfriend, girlfriend. Are these children who were produced in this manner entitled to maintenance from their fathers, knowing that there was no marriage contract between them and their mothers? And he answered, Ali rahmatullah, in the translation, in the case of those who had intercourse when they were not Muslims, if they believed that this intercourse came under a unison contract that they regarded as valid, i.e. both the couple, even though it is invalid according to Islam, to us, because they didn't marry according to how we married, but to their belief, like today here in England or all over, a boyfriend, they call them partner, civil partner, and that is fine with them, then Islam acknowledges the children as children born in wedlock, and the relationship between the two people is valid. Then the children belong to the man. This is the Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen carrying on. For example, when he was a non-Muslim, a man proposed to a woman that she should be his wife, and she agreed, and they thought that this was a relationship marriage type of contract. Then the man and woman become Muslim. In the case, we say that the marriage contract is valid and does not need to be renewed, and the children that they have had together belong to them. So to those who lived as a civil partners, if you believe that your relationship with this woman was marriage, then it is not fornication, and the children belong to you. This is the beauty of Islam. We're not here to judge people. A lot of people look at the English or the French or the German or the Westerners having boyfriend and girlfriend, and we look at them as a very belittling, very arrogant way, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at things completely different. But if you believe that the couple themselves, let's say a boyfriend, English and American, whatever it is, they live and they believe it was fornication, then if they embrace Islam and they accept the children, he said, then if you accepted these children as yours when you are not a Muslim, then they are your children when you are Muslim. What he means by this, let's say a couple was just a one-night stand and the baby is born, and then the man embraces Islam and the woman embraces Islam, and they had a child out of just like it was a one-night stand, just like purely for sex. But the man, after when he embraces Islam, accepts that the child is his, and the woman accepts that the child is hers, then the child is theirs. You understand? You see what the beauty of Islam is here? And this is the fatwa of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen alayhi rahmatullah. So again, this pep talk is not going to speak about the people of the world, but rather about those children that are born to Muslim parents. And the whole pep talk will deal with this issue unless otherwise stated, and I don't believe we'll deal with non-Muslim children at all. Now, let me start here by mentioning to you, if you ask the Sheikh, say in Saudi Arabia, the Wahhabi state or the Salafi state as they like to call themselves, and you ask them, or in Egypt or North Africa, wherever you go in the Muslim world, and you ask them about the status of those children that are born out of a Muslim wedlock, what will they tell you? They will give you answers that these answers have been with us for the last 1,200 years. These issues of fiqh or the Islamic jurisprudence and ruling sadly have been stagnant in our Islamic books for centuries without any tangible studies to challenge the old rulings that deal with the children that are born out of a wedlock. The status and position of those children, as preached before and now to our days, is that the majority of the men of religion and scholars do not bring anything new to the table. All they do is reiterate and say again what has been said again, or read loudly to you what has been written in our books. Nothing. Even if Islam's universality is about to flourish and people are getting to know Islam, but we have those little things that are in Islam that are causing people to run away from Islam, not because Islam has them, but because of the way our men of religion and scholars interpreted them. As I have mentioned already before, the way Islam is presented today in this ever-changing world is an over 13 centuries and a half old Islam. That version doesn't work with our needs, and a much fresher view is highly required rather than it is presented today. And when I mean fresher, I don't mean change those things that don't change. It's not like saying Salat is 5, let's make 3 because people are busy today. No. I'm talking, it's not about those rituals that we perform, Hajj, Salat, Ramadan, and Zakat. No, this can't change because they are the way they are. What I'm talking more is about the social status, our interaction with the human world. When our Islam was designed, it was designed by Bani Umayyah, Bani Abbas, and the Turkish Empire. They were designed by scholars who were part of a dynasty that was strong. We were forced to reckon with. We were the superpower of that time. So the Islam they wrote at that time was very belittling when it comes to interaction with the other people. For example, to them, that is Muslim and kafir. You see a person walking in the street and people refer to them as kafir, when in fact that is not the true meaning, and I will cover this another day. So let's see first what Muslims are going through today. We find that Muslims are finding themselves in front of a new world that is evolving, changing, adjusting, and growing. This new world is intelligent and is creating laws to help it manage situations, problems it faces on a daily basis. So if someone on or yourself wanted to know the status of those children that are born out of a wedlock, you will certainly hit with the following answer. First thing first, what's being said today? As it stands now, in the new and in the past, here is what they are still say and are saying, what they said and they will keep saying. Only Allah knows when that's gonna change. First thing first, children out of wedlock are not and will not be held responsible by Allah of their origin. On paper and inside the books of fiqh, this is great, that the child is not held responsible for what his parents have done. But in reality, the Muslim community at large, and even worldwide, in the Muslim worldwide, they have a very nasty prejudice when it comes to children born out of a wedlock. Muslims worldwide do judge, abuse, mistreat, and belittle any child they find that he or she is the child of unmarried parents. In Egypt, and so many Muslim world today countries, they have houses for orphans. But did you know that the majority of these children are not orphans? They are kids born out of a wedlock. And I will put here at the end of my pep talk a video, a small video clip here, that shows you how these kids are being treated or mistreated in one of the houses or places where they take care of those kids that are born out of a wedlock. And you see how the Muslim world, because that is a representation of what truly goes out there. Muslim worldwide, as I said, do judge, abuse, mistreat, and belittle any child that they find that he or she is the child of unmarried parents. Very sadly, traditions rules, no matter how much scholars or preachers speak in the name of Islam, they always go back to that. Kids that are born out of unwed parents are kids of haram. and people will look at them, and scholars, they tell them, look, you can't hold the kids responsible. But even in the naming of scholars, when they deal with the kids of with the issue of kids that are born out of wedlock, they call them sons of fornication. How would you expect the day-to-day Abdullah that walks in the street to respect the child that the scholar called son of fornication? In the Muslim world, especially in the Arab world, if they want to insult somebody, they say Ibn al-Haram, son of haram, which means that you are son of unmarried parents. So how would you expect the Muslim world to respect those children, love them, care for them, when the scholars who teach Islam refer to these kids as sons of fornication? Even though Allah had said in the Quran, كُلُّ مْرِئٍ بِمَا كَسَبَ رَهِينٍ, every person is ransomed by what they have done. The kid will never ever carry the burden of his parents. But the problem is, what comes next? Sadly, there is a fabricated hadith that is spread like wildfire amongst Muslims around the world, and it has been traveling for the last 1300 years or more. This hadith is still present today in the books of hadith. It is in Al-Bayhaqi and also Al-Bukhari in At-Tariq Al-Kabir. Al-Bukhari has his authentic hadiths, but he also has other books of hadith where he places the other hadith that he doesn't deem as authentic as his Sahih Al-Bukhari. Yet, some of them he classified as Sahih. One of them is this hadith here that I'm going to speak about, or it's called The Great History. And this is Al-Bukhari's history book, and it has hadiths and things like that. But anyway, the hadith stipulates that لا يدخل الجنة ولد زنا, the son of a zaniya, or the daughter of a zaniya, adulterer, will not enter Jannah. This is a hadith that you can find in our books of fiqh. لا يدخل الجنة ولد زنا, the son of a zaniya or adulterer will not enter paradise. And for your information, Al-Bayhaqi was born in the year 384. That means almost four centuries after the migration of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Yet, as sad as it is, even though the Quran says different, but the texts of the Quran are thrown out, but fabricated hadith became the norm that Muslims around the world believe in and follow. And sadly, this hadith found popularity because it really suits and fits the Arab simple mentality and beliefs for abuse and stigma. The Arabs, they have this over-exaggerated matter about honor. Anyway, this is, however, another hadith. There is another, however, another hadith by Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal. Ahmed ibn Hanbal, they always glorify them. Glorify him, and this is in the Wahhabi and the Salafi, things like that, like the Muhyi Sunnah, the reviver of the Sunnah, the fighter of the Sunnah. They make him like he is biggest than life itself. And also in Abu Dawood, and these both hadiths, they claim that Abu Huraira is reported to have mentioned that Waladu Zina Sharru Thalatha, the son of adultery is the evilest or the worst of the three. Subhanallah. You have a man who fornicates with a woman. So we have here two fornicators, two disobedience of Allah. The child that is born is worse than the man and the woman. What kind of brain is that? What is the mercy of Islam in this? This hadith, as widely spread and practiced as it is amongst Muslims, is very, very weak and even considered fabricated. It is in the category of fabricated hadith, namely by great scholars of hadith, such Ibn al-Hajar al-Asqalani, who overshadows all scholars of hadith. They call him Amir al-Mu'mineen, the king of the rulers of hadith. And he died like 500 years ago. And also Ad-Darqutni, one of the teachers of Imam al-Bukhari, who is in the same league as al-Bukhari. But sadly, very sadly, another scholar of hadith, called Ibn al-Jawzi. And he died 510. That is 500 years after Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He classified this hadith as Hassan, as good source hadith. Now, this you will think, Ya Allah, what's this? We've got scholars, even though the meaning is absolutely rubbish, yet we have a scholar of hadith that says, no, this hadith is good. the calamity that befalls the whole thing is Sheikh Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah, who died in 1999, so he's in our time. In his book of the chain of authentic hadith, classifies this hadith as good as well. He said it's hadith Hassan. Subhanallah, didn't Nasruddin Al-Albani, Sheikh Al-Albani, didn't he read the Quran? How come a baby, subhanallah, how come a baby is worse than the father and the mother? And obviously, once they say that this hadith is authentic, you will find those scholars, what they do is they try to justify. They can't say this hadith contradicts the Quran. But they will say, if this hadith is authentic according to Al-Albani, then the student or whoever will try to explain it. And look at the stupid explanation that they gave. They say, because the child of fornication will be abused by people and he will have like hatred in his heart, he will turn into evil. And as such, he becomes more evil than his father and his mother. Subhanallah. And this is in our books of fiqh. And these books of fiqh are being translated. And the world knows about Islam. How are we going to explain to the world now that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a religion of mercy? He brought the religion of mercy, is mercy to all mankind. And then we tell them that a child, a pure, beautiful child that is born out of that relationship of no fault, of no wishes of his, it is Allah who has designed that. Why do we blame the child? Why? Yeah, wallahi al-azim, this is like a head-wrecking thing. This is why in the Muslim world today, people look at the children of that come out of a wedlock in such an evil way, in a very, very evil way. Anyway, it always is the case when a hadith doesn't agree or something like that, those scholars that explain the meaning of the hadith, like Imam Nawawi and Ibn Hajar Asqalani and different scholars, they always say, perhaps Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant this. And then they build an argument, and that perhaps becomes because. And once it becomes a because, it becomes the reason. And this is how Islam has been transmitted to us. The Prophet ﷺ said this because. At the beginning it was perhaps he meant this. And then it changed into a because. And once what was a perhaps and a mere potential hypothesis becomes a reason to be for this hadith. Sadly so, the hadith authenticated by Al-Albani is at the root of this continuous stigma and hatred that those born because of a mistake made by their parents experience continuously and harshly. No wonder Allah's wrath and anger are upon us. And were it not that He is the ultimate, supreme, and sole merciful, He would have annihilated every bit of us to oblivion. Alhamdulillah for His infinite mercy. Now let us carry on with how the understanding of the past and the reiterations of the present look at those kids who came to life a little different than the rest of us. I will first mention what they say, which means what's being implemented these days, and I pray to Allah that such understandings get to leave us for good and to never return very soon. First, who should the child be attributed to? And whose name shall he, she carry? Once two people fornicate and a child is born, whose name is the child going to carry? When asked about who should the child be attributed to, they will tell you this. وَلَدُ الزِّنَا لَا يُنْسَبْ إِلَى الزَّانِي. The child born out of wedlock cannot be attributed or named after the male adulterer. And they further say, وَلَا تَجِبُ عَلَيْهِ تُجَاهُهُ نَفَقَةٌ وَلَا سُكْنَةٌ. And as such, financial support or habitat aren't the man's responsibility. They are not. The man is not forced, and there is no law that puts the man into spending or guaranteeing the habitat for that child. And then they add further to this, وَإِنَّمَا يُنْسَبُ إِلَى أُمِّهِ وَأَهْلِهَا نِسْبَةً شَرْعِيَّةً صَحِيحًا. But the child must be attributed to the mother and her family, and this attribution is lawful and Islamically sound. وَتَتَحَمَّلُ هِيَ نَفَقَتُهُ. And the child's financial support must be met by the mother. their evidence, when you ask them what that, where does this nonsense come from, what does this answer come from, they will tell you their evidence is in a hadith reported by Bukhari and Muslim, who reported, and obviously, as you know, when you compare in the Salafi or the Wahhabi statements or all these people, they will say Al-Bukhari is the most authentic book after Allah, and this is not true. However, when it comes to hadith, Al-Bukhari is the most authentic book that contains a great number of hadith. That's great. Comes after it, Muslim, Sahih Muslim, and then comes the other books. Any hadith that Al-Bukhari and Muslim agree upon becomes extremely stronger hadith. I will one day give a talk about Al-Bukhari and Muslim and the hadith so that you get a better idea. But for now, this hadith is reported by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, and as such, it is such a very strong hadith that nobody argues or says anything about it. The hadith says, "Al-waladu lil-firashi wa lil-ahiri al-hajar." The translation of the meaning is, the child is for the owner of the bed, and to the man fornicator, he gets but the rocks. He gets but the rocks is an Arabic expression that says that someone takes all the spoils and the other world gets nothing but the rocks of the earth. If you pay someone with the rocks of the earth, they're not going to accept it. So An-Nawawi alayhi rahmatullah, who is born 631 years after the migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, commented on this hadith saying, Al-Ahir is the male fornicator. As for him getting nothing but the rocks, he said, this is An-Nawawi, this is an expression the Arabs used to say that the child belongs to the mother and he gets out of that nothing at all about the father. Then he added saying, لِأَنَّ مَا الزَّانِي, and because the water or the sperm of the fornicator, مَا unfasid, is spoiled, bad, rotten. وَلِذَا لَا يُلْحَقُ بِهِ الْوَلَدِ, and this is why the kid cannot be attributed to the man. Today, hundreds of thousands, if not millions of children are being punished because of what one man said. It's not even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nawawi says a fornicator's sperm is spoiled, is rotten, is void, is not good to produce a child. Subhanallah, this is why he says the child is not attributed to the father. But watch what's coming up next. Furthermore, they say that the reason the child belongs to the owner of the bed, and here they mean the woman who is married. You see, they didn't say, okay, and if the girl is not married, they don't deal with that. They always assume that the fornicator is a man with a married woman. And I will tell you later on at the end of the talk why it always is the married woman. But anyway, they say the woman who is married, and this is why in Saudi Arabia, the Wahhabi, the Salafi, and all these things, they don't trust a woman at all. To them, a woman is as soon as you let her out, that's it. She's up for fornication. That's the mentality, the sick mentality in that extremist, radical group out there. But anyway, the woman who is married, and as such, she owns her bed in the bedroom along with her husband. They further said that even if her husband is away, and this is in Al-Mughni, by Ibn Qudama, and this is the foundation base of the Hanbali, the Wahhabi, the Salafi fiqh. This is the foundation of their fiqh. They say, even if the husband of the woman, the married woman, is away for 20 years, and his wife fornicates and gets impregnated by another man, then the child born must be attributed to the husband regardless of his 20 years being away. This rule, in my dear sisters and my brother, exists in Al-Mughni of Ibn Qudama. And as I said, this is the foundation book of the Hanbali, Salafi, Wahhabi school of thought, Saudi Arabia, and any Salafi around the world subscribes to this ridiculous ideology. Subhanallah, a man is away for 20 years. His wife sleeps with another man, gets pregnant, gives a birth. In our Islamic understanding, the kid belongs to the man who is 20 years away from his wife. What kind of logic in this thing? But anyway, let's go to inheritance of the child. When it comes to inheritance, a Muslim that is born out of wedlock, a child that is born out of a wedlock, is said to not inherit from the man who impregnated the mother. Just as the same is as the man who impregnated the mother cannot inherit it from the child, even if the man acknowledges and confesses that he is the father of the child. It is always emphasized that the Islamic court will not accept the man's declarations or confessions. It doesn't matter if the man says, I slept with this woman and that child is mine, the DNA says it's mine. According to them, Islamic court will say that the child is not yours. And obviously, Islamic court is extremely innocent from such accusations. And then they say any statement, you know, whenever they say something, you tell what's your evidence. You tell them, what is the evidence? Instead of saying Allah says, they straightway jump to the hadith. They say, أَيُّمَا رَجُلٍ عَاهِرٍ, any man who fornicates with a free woman or with a slave, فَالْوَلَدُ وَلَدُ زِنَا, then the child is the child of adultery. I swear to Allah the Almighty, with all what I have in my heart, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم would never ever utter that the child is a child of zina, him whose life is Al-Quran, as I will say later on, I will explain later on through the Quran. Impossible that Rasulullah ﷺ would point a finger and he would say that that child is the child of zina. This is nothing else but the political Islam, and I will speak later on that labeled those children like that, and I will tell you the reason why they did that. And they'll say, لا يرث ولا يورث, the child does not inherit nor is he to be inherited from. And again, as I said, this is the hadith, is the foundation of the Wahhabi, Salafi, and anyone who follows that ilk. When it comes to his marriage or to her marriage, when it comes to marrying a child that is born out of a wedlock, none of the recognized scholars ever forbade marriage. They say, yes, if a child is born out of a fornication, they can marry any other Muslim as long as they are Muslim. No big deal, no problem at all. However, and as usual and quite often, when the evidences aren't strongly sharp and conclusive, some scholars will throw a tantrum and disagree. This is exactly what happened and still is happening in the Hanbali, Saudi, Wahhabi, Salafi.com school of thought. They say that if a child is born out of a wedlock, people are going to insult him with that. They will always call him son of fornication, Ibn Zina. If this is a man who marries a noble woman, then the woman will be insulted. Her children will be insulted because of the father. If it is the girl, the same thing. The man is going to be insulted. You married a woman that is born out of wedlock. His children out of that woman are going to be insulted. And at that, they say, we cannot allow a man who is born from a parent to be insulted by saying you are the wife of a bastard or you are the husband of a bastard. Then they say, Islamically, it's not acceptable. And as such, they prohibited the marriage of a child that is born out of wedlock with that of a child born from two parents. And this is absolutely nonsense. It is so sad that people have reached such a low level. They even ask, if a child is born out of fornicating parents, do they deserve funeral praise at their time of death? It is unbelievable but true. It's heartbreakingly but true. People want to strip the wedlockless children of their birthright duty as Muslims, that we should pray on them and ask Allah for the mercy to them. Many people personally have been asking me about this. What is the status of a Muslim child that is born out of wedlock? Shall we pray on them or not? The answer is the masses of the Council of the Saudi Scholars issued a fatwa, and this is very sad. They didn't need to issue a fatwa, but because people in Saudi Arabia ask the Salafi people, the Wahhabi people ask questions, this kind of idiotic question, and then the scholars answered, if his mother is a Muslim, then we pray on him and her, and there is no blame on him, i.e. the son who is born or the daughter who is born, for what his parents have done. Did we really need this type of fatwa? But this is the dark stigma that surrounds those wedlockless children. those children that are born out of marriage. Such ill-formulated thinking has been implanted in the hearts and minds of people because of the teachings of our scholar. How can we expect the world to accept Allah's Islam when it has been totally colored by the man-made Islam, by the political-made Islam? It's sad, it very is sad. I will stop here on the part number one, and I will, inshallah, on part number two of this talk, speak about the other side of the coin. What has Islam truly said away from this political and this closed mind thinking? Is there any other sayings you'll be amazed to know? Yes, there is. A great number of scholars have said a lot of things that are different. And the reason why this closed mind Islam preached is because the Salafi scholars, those extremist people, they thought the more they narrow the grip on people, the more they make it tough on people, that is how they are pious. That is how people show piety. And this is not how Allah wants it. I will end the first part about those children that are born out of a wedlock marriage, and I will, inshallah, carry on part two. This is again your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. If you want to join my group, please do send me a message on WhatsApp or join my YouTube channel. My telephone number is 078-7640-8735, and if you are international, just add 0044. This is England. Or you go on my YouTube channel, Islam Pep Talk, and you will find a great number of my talks and there. And Allah knows more. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad, and inshallah, up to part two. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.